Welcome you to today's Samvaad Talk. It's by Professor Sujit, Kumar, Chakrabarti. Sujit and I together manage a lab called the Software Engineering Lab. He is the software engineer of the Software Engineering Lab. I don't do any programming. So Mr. Cynthia gave me a paper to introduce Sujit, but I don't think I need that to introduce him. He's an electrical engineer by training in his master's and UG, but slowly moved into computer science and now, in my opinion, an expert programmer and researcher in formal methods. Broadly works in the area of formal methods, software testing, software engineering, more on the applied aspects than on the theoretical aspects. So it's a pleasure to introduce Sujit and welcome to Samvaad Talk by him.
Welcome everyone. Good afternoon and happy Dasera wishes. This happens to be the first talk after the midterm break. And it's quite heartening to see that people have turned up in good numbers in spite of that. So thanks and hope we'll make your stay here for the next 1.5 hours worthwhile. The topic of this talk is algorithms in automated software engineering. It was somewhat, the experience of actually titling this talk was somewhat similar to writing a thesis when one fine day I suddenly realized that I have to put 3-4 different pieces of disparate works together in the same book and I have to come up with a title. So I thought automated software engineering would be too broad, which is my research interest. So I just put that algorithms in to make it look more specific. So that's so much about the talk title. So just to introduce to you, some of you who probably think of software engineering as a very broad area, I would like to present this slide and it will hopefully, you know, dispel some myths. Okay, so typically people understand software engineering when we say software engineering, things like agile, waterfall, big planning sheets, delivery models, DevOps, edge, and all these things come into your mind. So that typically is covered under the processes aspect of software engineering, which is something that we categorically do not do in our lab. Okay, what we really do is the other part, which is automated software engineering, where we talk about the idea of automating all the things that software engineers have been traditionally doing manually. Okay, so we write algorithms which purport or at least aim to automate some of the things that software engineers have been doing for ages as human activities. The middle part, this empirical software engineering, is also becoming a very strong branch of software engineering, which is essentially taking a lot of data that is generated through software engineering activities and then running different types of analytics, machine learning, etc., and coming out with knowledge about the industry, about the software artifacts, the processes, etc. That is the empirical aspect of software engineering that is also emerging as a very important area of software engineering. However, as I said, we belong to this third category, both me and Meenakshi, and that's what our lab is about. Precisely. Software is by default about automation, but software automates things belonging to different domains like code writing is one of the things that software engineers do. So yes, that is in the ambit of automated software engineering. Yes, but software engineers do a lot of other things, for example, requirement analysis, testing, maintenance, reverse engineering, and so on. Those are all also things which we try to automate through software, automated software engineering. So what is automated software engineering? The goal is to automate software engineering activities, hopefully fully, but typically it happens partially because software engineering, software development by default is a very creative activity. So automating it is not a very easy thing to do. So we have been able to achieve some amount of automation there. So we basically study techniques for constructing, understanding, adapting, modeling software artifacts and processes. And what kind of artifacts do we come out with? We come out with various kind of knowledge representations or models of software artifacts and processes, and we develop some sort of intelligence, I wouldn't call it artificial intelligence, on top of that. And primarily, at least in our sphere of activities, we use a lot of formal methods to achieve automation. Applications of automated software engineering are very, very wide, pretty much covers all the phases of software development lifecycle, starting from specification, architecture, design, implementation or coding, testing, verification, validation, maintenance, evolution, all these things. Automated software engineering has touched all these areas of activity. And as far as domains are concerned, initially the journey started with embedded and safety critical systems, but now formal methods and embedded automated software engineering has started touching other non-safety critical domains like web-based, computer games, mobile apps. Everywhere formal methods and automated software engineering finds application. So that's a little bit of first part of introduction. We already have started introducing the talk. So this is the introduction section. After that, my first PhD student, Ms. Karthika, will talk about the requirement engineering aspect of what we do. And after that will be followed Ms. Varsha's talk. She will talk about the work that we have been doing in software testing. After that, I will talk a little bit more about some other pieces of work. For the want of a better word, I have used this word SUPW, which actually is the name of a very neglected subject of my school times. And as I grew older, I realized that that is one of the most important subjects that we had neglected, but we should have studied well. So I thought that let me name this section of my talk as SUPW, which is essentially socially useful productive work. And I think this is something that all of us researchers must do as a part of our work. So these are the four parts.
You want your son to be more comfortable, that's why he used the word.
Yeah, I hope he's listening to this thing. So what I will do is just to avoid being completely non-technical, I have sprinkled a little bit of technical thing in my part of the talk. Most of the technical talk will be actually delivered by my students. So what I will do is I will discuss a little bit about this particular technique called symbolic execution, which we use heavily in many of our works. And in fact, in both the pieces of work on requirement engineering as well as software testing, you will actually see this particular technique being used in two different flavors. So let me just introduce in very, very brief what this basically means through kind of an animated slide. So let us say that, you know, you have this particular program, right? So I have represented it using a particular notation which you would like to call control flow graph, or flow chart, whatever you like, doesn't make a difference. So basically, I'm sure most of you understand what this basically means. So if I were to do concrete execution, which is essentially the kind of execution that we all know, then the way it would proceed is as follows. So let's say that we have visited the first node, and as a result, we give value 1 to the variable I, just arbitrarily. Then the execution proceeds through the various nodes, and the various variables start getting concrete values depending upon the variables, the expressions that are getting evaluated and which are being assigned to those variables. And the main point to note here is that all these variables I, j are always having some sort of a concrete value, here it being a number, all the time during the execution of the program. And now depending upon those values, the execution path that the particular instance of execution will take will be decided. For instance, here I happens to have value 4, therefore it is not less than 1, and therefore the false branch will be taken and output will be 4. Okay. In another instance of concrete execution, we may end up giving minus 1 to I. As a result, the execution will proceed, and then at this point, since I happens to be less than 1, the true branch of the if branch will be taken, and the output will be zero. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, at any point in time, when we are doing concrete execution, the flow will be along one particular path through the control flow graph. That is the takeaway thing. However, when we are executing the same program symbolically, something slightly fundamentally different will happen. What will happen? So here, when I'm executing the program symbolically, I will assign a symbolic value rather than a concrete value. So you see that alpha there, which has been assigned to I. So it doesn't have any particular concrete value. It's some symbolic value, and alpha is called a symbolic variable. And then the ensuing executions will result in calculation of symbolic expressions based upon or depending upon the symbolic variables which have been assigned to various values. And the expressions, so the values that will be assigned to various variables will be symbolic expressions rather than concrete values, as in the case of concrete execution. So this is the only difference. So what happens then? So the interesting thing happens when we hit a decision block. When we hit a decision block, we assume, for example, we may assume that this whole expression, which is the value of I, is less than 1, in which case we will take the true branch. Okay. However, there is no reason to think that that is the only truth. The other truth could be that that whole expression is more than or greater than or equal to 1, in which case the other branch can also simultaneously be taken. Okay. So in other words, in the same symbolic execution run, right, the both the branches of an if branch can be taken. Okay. That is the only interesting thing that happens in a symbolic execution. And what comes out of the entire execution are, again, symbolic expressions rather than concrete values, since there are no concrete values being evaluated during this execution. So this is the only difference between a concrete execution and symbolic execution. More about these things in the specific pieces of work that we will be presenting. So turns out that symbolic execution is an extremely useful technique, an extremely useful tool to do various kinds of static analysis on programs. So it has been traditionally used for generating test inputs, which Varsha will throw more light upon. The thing is, it started being used in a practical sense only as late as 2005, even though the first time it was actually introduced was as far back as 1970s. And the reason was, we didn't simply have computers which are powerful enough to be able to do symbolic execution in a practical manner. So symbolic execution happens to be a computationally intensive method to work with, but it with more powerful computers and with more powerful constraint solvers and theorem provers coming into picture, symbolic execution has turned out to be a major program analysis technique. So just to give you a flavor of why symbolic execution happens to be a computationally expensive thing to do, here is a simple flowchart, another flowchart, which has this little loop here, okay, and it does some calculations inside the loop, and if the loop, it exits the loop, it just halts. Okay, so how would I do symbolic execution on this particular thing? Well, if alpha happens to be the value of I, so if it happens to be less than 10, then we will go into the loop, otherwise we'll halt. Inside the loop, there is an if branch, so we will have two possibilities. Both those possibilities will end up in our returning back to the this particular decision block through this particular path, and then the same decisions have to be taken repeatedly. And if you are good with your basics of your trees and you know, other things, you will see that the number of paths that we are ending up creating through this is growing exponentially with every decision block. Okay, so that is the reason why this particular tree will very soon become very, very wide. Okay, the number of leaves will be exponential in the number of times we traverse this particular loop, And that is one of the biggest problems in actually practically implementing symbolic execution as a practical software analysis tool. However, as I said, there are various optimizations that have been devised. There are practical scale symbolic execution engines already available off the shelf, and people have used to do major software analysis activities on very large industrial strength software systems using symbolic execution. So this was just to give you a primer on symbolic execution, so that the kind of the term, the terminology is not new to you when it is used in specific context of the works. I will leave it at that. Okay. So then let me just introduce what Karthika is going to speak about. Karthika is going to speak about the requirement engineering piece of work. And as you all must be knowing, the activity of requirement engineering is nothing but the process of defining, documenting, maintaining requirements, okay, picked up from Wikipedia. And it is absolutely important. You probably must have come across this particular cartoon, which shows the various angles through which the various stakeholders in any software project would look at the software. So this is how the customer has explained. This is how the project leader has understood. This is how the analyst has understood, and so on. You know, so the various stakeholders of the project have looked at the problem in various different ways. Some of them are hardly realistic, as you can say. Some of them are insipid. Some of them are vacuous. Okay. And what really the user may have had in his mind was probably absolutely simple. Okay. So all these complications arise, and that essentially arises because the communication about what is really needed has not been passed around in the among the stakeholders in a effective and efficient manner. And that is basically the business of requirement engineering. We basically want to ensure that the requirements of the software project are understood well, and they are understood well by everyone who is involved. So so what do we do software? So from the context of automated software engineering, what is requirement engineering? Well, we basically try to create formal specifications and analyze them, hopefully automatically. Okay. As a result, a host of various languages have been created to be used as formal specification languages. Okay, these are some of them, as many of you probably already know. And then, once you have software specifications written in one of these languages, one of these formal languages, it is supposed to have some sort of semantic or meaning of itself, and therefore it lends itself well for automated analysis. So we automatically analyze those formal specifications using various formal methods techniques and try to see if there is anything wrong with those software specifications. Another flank of requirement engineering, automated requirement engineering, is taking software requirement specifications written in natural language documents, Word documents, etc., and then turning them into formal models, which can be then subjected to automated analysis. Right. Right. So that kind of tool is essentially useful in capturing and actually taking a few steps towards formalizing your software requirement. So you can say that it is not as bad as a plain old Word document, but it is nowhere as close as, let's say, a finite state model, which is really a formal document which captures your requirement. So it is somewhere, you know, in between. It's a, you can say it's a semi-formal model, and people have been working on taking this kind of models and then turning them into formal specification. So if you look at something written in Word document, it is often too much for algorithms to really make sense of them in a mathematical manner. So so this kind of tools that you are talking, DOORS, Requisite Pro, etc., they are tools which are taking a natural language document or a requirement, and then taking a first few steps to towards formalization. So yeah, that's natural language processing. And then just like any other software artifact, code, okay, requirements written in one of these languages are likely to have bugs, okay. There are some bugs, technical terms, not immediately important to understand them, but there can be bugs, and we use various formal tools to analyze them, just like compilers are used to analyze your program to see whether they have bugs or not. We have tools to analyze formal specifications to see if there are bugs or not. One such tool we have ourselves tried to develop. So that's basically the build up to what Kartika is going to present, and now I invite Kartika to present her work on requirement specification and analysis.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Kartika. I am doing my PhD under Sujit sir. So the work that I am going to explain now is formal specification for web applications using state charts. So as we know, as we saw in the previous slide that was presented by sir, that formal specifications are quite commonly used in safety critical applications. In the sense, it is widely used in aircraft and in embedded systems, in hardware systems and so on, where they consider that the testing system after development incurs a huge cost. So they want to model it previous to the development, and they try to test it using these formal methods. So often they consider these formal methods are too expensive. That's why it is not quite used in web applications or in normal software development. And it also has a steep learning curve. In the sense, the formal methods are too mathematical for the general software engineers and practitioners to adapt. So in our work, the motivation was this. So in order to use formal specification for non-safety critical domains like web applications, we have to have a specification language that is easy to understand, that is user-friendly, and it is well-known, like state charts. And we want to customize the language in order to adapt the needs of a web application. And when we wanted to also formally verify such a specification language that we are developing. So as a part of this work, we have developed a specification language called as StaBL, which is inspired by state chart, and we have cataloged the certain bugs that are possible when a specification engineer writes a specification, and we are also aiming to detect the bugs using program analysis and model checking. So StateCharts is a widely known specification language. It was proposed in 1980s in order to model the embedded systems by Herald. Now, it is also used in software development community, in the sense in UML StateCharts in the design phase it is used. And there are several implementations like IBM Rational Rose, and then Rhapsody, StateMate, State flow. Each of them has their own semantics of state charts, and they provide certain notations, they avoid certain notation, they introduce certain notations, but there are variations from the initial proposition made by Herald. So this is one example of state chart. This also explains the complexity of how state chart can be in order to write it as well as to verify it manually. In a sense, there are various aspects that you can see in this state chart. There are initial states which are marked with the dark circle, and then there are composite states, that is a state within another state, and a state moves from there are transitions between these states, and there are actions that happens during these transitions, and once we enter into a certain state, some action state takes place. When we exit from a certain state, certain action state takes place. And also there are history states, choice states. So there are certain set of pseudo states that are that were defined as part of the state charts. So it was basically an extension of a finite state automata, where they introduced OR states, AND states, history states, hierarchical states, and action language in to a finite state automata in order to make it more expressible to represent an embedded software. Now, in our work, we have created a language that is a state chart based language for specification of web apps. So in our language, we have introduced this local variables and the scoping rules of local variables. So in traditional state charts, there is no concept of local variables. So all the variables have to be declared in the global space. And so these local variables are specific to a certain state and they are visible within a certain state only. So we'll be seeing that in a while. And also we are defining the interstate data flow. So we have developed a compiler to verify the specifications that we have written. And also we have created the verification methodology in order to identify certain classes of bugs. So this is one of the examples that we have created using StateChart. So here, this is a general student management system. So there is a state called student management. And you can see that there are... What is? Oh. So here you can see that this is a state. It's a composite state. It contains many states inside. And then these are variables. Students' rooms are variables, which is a map of integer and string. And rooms is a map of integer and integer. So these kind of variables can be created within the states. And these states also have the transitions. And these variables are local to this particular state. So logged out user and password are local to the logged out state. And logged in, the logged in user is local to this particular state. So like that. So there is the notion of hierarchy of states. There is a notion of states and transitions. Whereas the difference here is that we have this notion of local variables. And we are also defining the scope of these local variables. So this is nothing but the in the transitions, what are the guards and actions that are there. So for example, when I'm going from logged out to logged in state, so if I'm going on the transition from logged out to login state, what has to be done is the username and the password has to be checked against the set of users that are already available. If the username and password belongs to the set of registered users, then the user should be moved into the logged in state. So that is what is written here. So in T login, the guard is, so get map. So from the set of students, give the username as the input and identify a student whether that student is already available. If he is available, then the guard becomes true and then this action is executed where we say that the logged in user becomes the user who logged in. So on this T login, we assign this log, once this guard becomes true, once in the action of this T login, we say that logged in user becomes this particular user who logged in. So like this, so this is a small example on the state chart specification. So as we said, the scoping rules, so it is visible within for a variable that we are defining or declaring is visible within the state in which it is defined, and it is also visible in its substates, but it is not visible in the superstates. It is readable on its outgoing transition, writable on the incoming transition. So we'll see the example of this. So here you consider the state R, S, T, and U. R has a variable called W, S has a variable called X, T has a variable called Y, and U has a variable Z. So variable W is readable and writable inside R, which means it is readable and writable within this R and its substates. It is in S, T, and U also you can read and write it. And same way X can be read and written in S, T, and U. And in the transitions, so the incoming transitions can write the value of X. So for example, T2 can write the value of X, and outgoing transitions can read the value of X. So that is the, because when we are, so basically what we are trying to tell is when the state is active, before the state becomes active, you can initialize the variable in the state Whereas after the machine leaves that particular state, there is no point in reinitializing this value. So we are not allowing to reinitialize the value after in the outgoing transition of a state. So when we create such a state chart specification, there is a possibility of certain types of bugs that can occur, so like undefined variables, non-determinism, stuck specification, and there can be some security problems. So this is the path in which our research is progressing. So when there is first verification we issue that we are going to see is undefined variable. So consider this particular state chart which has P, Q, R, and S. Four states are there. So V is nothing but variable. N is the entry action. X is the exit action. So here, this small example, what it states is, in a state S, I want the value of A and B in the entry action. So is it possible to come to the state S without defining the value of A and B? So this is what we are trying to analyze here. So this means that it is possible that an undefined variable can reach this particular state. So here we can see that Q is the state which initialized the input, which initialized the variable A. R is the state which initialized the variable B. But the way the specification has been written, it is possible to reach the state S without defining B. In this path, you can reach the state S without defining A. So there are two paths here in which can result in undefined variable access. So can we automatically determine such kind of paths? So in that case, we will be able to automatically detect undefined variable in case a specification engineer by mistake writes such thing in a huge specification. So the method that we are following is, we are in the stable specification, we are going to flatten this state chart and then translate the state chart into a CFG. And then we are going to symbolically execute the state chart in order to identify whether the variable, undefined variable is possible, access is possible. Now, so the transformations that we are going to apply during flattening are globalizations. That is, we have a set of local variables. We are moving it into the global space because it has to be converted into CFG further, where all the variables will be in the global scope. And then we have to resolve certain type of transitions that are in our state charts, like atomic to atomic. So when we move from an atomic state to atomic state, whether there will be any changes in the transition and guards, and whether from the non-atomic state to atomic state, and from an atomic state to non-atomic state. So first step is globalization, make all variables to global, disambiguate the variables if required. So for example, T and U have a variable called X, which is renamed as T underscore X and V U underscore X, and it is also renamed in all the possible actions and guard. Now the second type of resolution transformation that happens is from a non-atomic state to an atomic state when a transition is going to happen. So it means that there is a transition from U to V and T to V as well. So we are going to create two new transitions, preserving the guards and actions. Now the third type of transition is atomic to non-atomic state. So when the transition is from atomic to non-atomic, it means that on a transition T, state will move from V to U, because U is the initial state of this composite state. So we are transforming this transition from V to U. So we are creating one more new transition here. So like this, we are applying steps in order to flatten the state chart. So here, when we are going to transfer from transform from an atomic state to an atomic state, how we are going to flatten it is, so an atomic state can be inside certain set of composite states. And in that case, when you're moving from S1 to D1, source to destination, you have to exit S1, S2 till SN, and then you have to enter into DM, D2 till D1. which means that the exit of all these states has to be incorporated into this transitions action, and the entry of all these states has to be incorporated into this transition action. So this action of new transition will become exit of S1, S2 till SN, and the action of transition, the preserving that action of transition, and then entry into DM, DM minus 1 till D1. So like this, we are transforming the atomic to atomic state. So at last step of flattening, the hierarchy can be purged. So after we convert, we flatten the state chart, we are converting the state chart into a control flow graph. So how we are converting it into a control flow graph is we are maintaining a variable for event and state. So the current state is stored in the state variable, and then an event, whenever an event occurs, it checks on which state it is. And if the state matches with S of T, then on this event, if it is equal to E, then this particular transition should happen, and the state variable should be initialized to the destination state. So the current state moves to the next state of the transition, and then the action of T is executed. So we are converting the flattened state chart into a control flow graph, which is nothing but an indefinite while loop, which waits for an event to occur, and it matches the state and the event, and performs the appropriate actions. So we can see the translation of our example of student management, where all the variables are moved to the global space, and then you have a wait for event, match state. If it is in dashboard, if the event is eSetRoom, then the new state becomes setRoom. Else if event is eViewDetails, then the new state the variable is initialized to viewDetails, and the student becomes logged in user. So this is nothing but the entry action of the this is nothing but the action statement of eViewDetails of the state chart example that we saw. So like this, we convert the state chart into CFG. Now we have a CFG in it. We will be able to analyze if there is any problem, that is, if there is an undefined variable access in the CFG. So how we are going to do it is, so we are again revisiting the same example of our state chart where we saw the undefined variable access, where we saw that there are two parts that exist where there is undefined variable access. So we are going to perform symbolic execution here. So symbolic execution, sir has already explained the symbolic execution algorithm. So the only thing that is different in this is we are considering the depth, that is, we are going to go through, we are taking an input parameter depth along with the program. So the symbolic execution is going to happen only till that certain depth, and it is also going to, so we are using a queue in order to store the values, the symbolic execution values for each and every variable and so on. And then we are identifying whether, and in each step, whether that path constraint is satisfiable. If it is satisfiable, we are going to proceed further. If it is not satisfiable, we will not proceed further in that path. So this is the symbolic execution algorithm. So if here an example of an addition. So for in the environment sigma, so for a variable E1 is the value that is assigned to variable V1, and then E2 is the value that is symbolic value that is assigned to variable V2. Then when we are going to have a statement like add V1 and V2, then the symbolic value that is assigned is E1 plus E2. So in our work, we are not dealing with loops, because the symbolic execution may become like huge, as discussed by sir, when you have loops, you have an exponentially large path. So we are not dealing with loops currently. And then the function calls, recursive functions we are not supporting, whereas functions with no loop inside, we are expanding it in line. And for library functions called like putMap and getMap, which has a certain structure, we are expanding it in a specialized manner like this. So put map is going to be expanded like this. That is, there is a map with a key and value. So when you are going to put a value into the map, depending on this key, we are going to check whether the key matches with the key in the map. If so, you are going to place that value into the map. If not, you are going to check with the next key, and so on. So this is how the putMap function generally works. And then the getMap function, how it works is, it is going to check whether the key is available in the map. If it is so, if it is going to return a value that corresponds to the key. Now, if it is available, then it is going to return a result. If it is not available, it is going to return an error. Now, in the undefined variable access, so we saw this program, the control flow graph, that program in the previous slide. So these are some annotations that we have added in order to do the symbolic execution. So this is nothing but we are going to have a defined variable for each and every variable. So for A, so our aim is whether A and B are undefined when it is going to reach the state S. So what we are going to do is, for each and every variable, we are going to have a defined variable, and then we are going to set it to false. When the variable is actually defined, we are going to set it to true. So at each and every point where the variable is assigned, so for example, capital A is assigned to small a. So in this case, we are going to check whether A is already defined. So how we are going to check is, we are going to assert not of A defined. So if there is any problem, it will result in an error and it will give me a counter example. So that's how we are symbolically executing this program in order to identify an undefined variable is reaching a particular program point. Now, some more bugs that we have found are non-determinism and stuck specification. So non-determinism is inherent to state charts, wherein the on a certain event, there can be two states which can be reached. That is, on an event T, it is possible to reach two states. So it is possible to define such thing, but it is good for a specification engineer to know that there is a non-determinism present in a state chart. And also we have something called as a stuck specification. So in stuck specification, is it possible to reach a state so that it is, for example, it will forever remain in state A. There is no possibility of leaving state A. So is it possible to have such state in our specification? So that is a stuck specification. So in order to identify non-determinism, the solution that we are trying to use is whether at any given at this point of interest, is it possible to have guard 1 and guard 2 to be true, and guard 2 and guard 3 to be true, or guard 1 and guard 3 to be true. So the events are same at this event, whether it is possible that two guards can be at a time, it can be true. So in that case, non-determinism is possible. In order to find the stuck specification, we are trying to identify whether both of these guards will never be true. So if it can be found that both of these guards will never be true, then there is a possibility of stuck specification. So these are the works that we are currently involved in the formal specification, that is providing a specification language for web application and then providing an environment for a specification engineer in order to identify the common bugs that are possible in while writing a specification.
Let's move on to the other part after this, which is about testing. So again, just to give you a slight preview of what researcher in software testing typically do. Here is the typical architecture of how testing happens. So we have this program under test on the extreme left. This is the test, that is the program that we want to test. Okay, and for that we want to generate test cases. In order to do that, we essentially translate that particular program under test into some sort of a mathematical model. And that's what we mean by saying we are identifying the test requirements, and on that mathematical model, we basically define some sort of coverage criteria. So that mathematical model could be a graph, it could be an input space, an algebraic space, it could be a set of logical formulae, etc. And depending upon what kind of mathematical model we are using to represent this, we also define test requirements on top of them. Based upon those test requirements, we compute the inputs or the test inputs that will result in the satisfaction of those test requirements. Those are the test inputs that we generate, which are then given to the test harness to execute the test, and that gives us test results. Test results, depending upon whether you are doing white box testing or black box testing, will also be compared with a test oracle, that is a system or a criterion which will tell you whether your test passed or failed. So here we are typically going to talk about a white box method of testing, which means we do not have any explicit test oracle. All we are trying to do is to develop some sort of a coverage on a representation of the program under test. So this is the basic primer that I wanted to give you. From this point on, Varsha will discuss about her work on software testing.
I'm Varsha, working under Professor Sujit. So I'll be explaining symbolic execution of how we are exploiting symbolic execution on embedded systems. So we are exploiting the idea that if a program is represented by like a control flow graph, we are able to reach the different program points like B1, B2, B3, B4 by considering the branch predicates. By conjuncting these predicates, that means if we want to reach this point B1, we are taking this y less than 10, and we are taking x greater than 20 and z less than 10, then again we are adding the next predicate to it. On solving that formula, we will reach this program point. Similarly, the program point B2, in that case, we are taking the NOT of this predicate. So this will be the predicates, path predicates for this point B1, B2, B3, and B4. So how we are using this in an embedded system? For this, we are taking a fragment of a Simulink model, which have two decision blocks, which represents first if statement for U greater than 10 and then U equal to 10. We have two branches for each of this. And this represents the CFG, the control flow graph for the program fragment that shown before. And we have marked two edges in bold, which represents the edges which we are interested in. So if you are using a normal concolic testing in which where we use random inputs to cover this edges, first we may not cover the target edges with a single iteration or something. Here we'll take three iterations to cover this two target edges. But in our method, in SymTest, within one iteration itself, we'll be able to cover these two target edges. So here, the one thing is like, if we are representing any embedded system like digital circuits in a control flow graph manner, there will be a part, like a cyclic core part. It's like there will be one infinite loop. Within this, there will be some kind of a cyclic core. This will be explained later on. So we are proposing SymTest for a subset of control flow graph which contains this acyclic core. Then a SymTest is basically symbolic execution and the constraint solving. Here we have a generalized edge coverage, and we will be able to generate optimized test sequence length. And then we have increased control over the test paths we have generated. And also in SymTest, it may not be always true that we'll get the feasible path from the control flow graph. So in that cases, we need to add some heuristics for that. In that case, SymTest have the power that we are able to add more and more heuristics to it to make the system better. Then this is the problem statement in which if we have a program in the form of a control flow graph and we have a set of edges like the target edges, then we need to generate at a sequence that covers these all target edges. So, and also we need to keep the length of this generated test sequence as small as possible. So our approach is like, first we need to identify the syntactically optimal path that covers the set of target edges. And if that path is feasible, we will return the test sequence obtained. If it is not feasible, we need to find out the next feasible path. For this, we are using backtracking. So this is how an acyclic core would be. First, it will contain some initialization part. Then there will be one infinite loop. Within this, there will be an input block. It will contain the values, new values for the input from the environment. Then the forward propagation part, this will not contain any loops. It will not contain any loop, and it all in the within an infinite loop. So we are proposing SymTest for a subset of control flow graphs containing this kind of acyclic core. So this is an overall algorithm for SymTest, where first we will find a path. First we will find the path, and if that path is satisfiable, then it will compute the test sequence. If the path is not satisfiable, we will find for another path which is satisfiable using backtracking. And again, if you are not able to figure out the satisfiable path, it might result in failure. So if for fine path algorithm, the inputs will be the control flow graph of the represented program and the set of target edges. So on success, the output will be a path which contains this target edges, and on failure, it will show error. So we are also keeping in mind to reduce the number of iterations going through this control flow graph. So in fine path algorithm, in path, it's like we will be generating path till acyclic core, and then we will find path for the acyclic core. So it is split into two. First, we will find the path till acyclic core, then from acyclic core. So here, in each of these cases, we'll get a set of paths. From this set of paths, we'll be taking a path which contains more number of target edges, so that we can cover the target edges with minimum number of test sequences. Then this is a control flow graph for a program. So here there are three conditions. So the graph will be like this. And in order to cover this, this red edges means the target edges. In order to cover these target edges, here we are taking two iterations. To cover this three target edges, we are taking two iterations. But it is not always true that we will get satisfiable paths for every control flow graph. There are some kind of control flow graphs from which we will not be able to generate feasible paths. So this fine path algorithm will not compute a syntactically optimal path for this kind of control flow graph. Here, the optimal path is like E1, E3, E4, E6 and E2, E7, E8, E9. But SymTest is producing three sequences for it, E1, E3, E4, E5, E7, E8, E9, and then E2, E7, E8, E9, then E1, E3, E4, and E6. So it's like SymTest is not always producing optimal syntactic paths. Then here is an example. This is a control flow graph for a program fragment. And this represents a trace of symbolic execution. This is the trace for the edges, the means the path from E1, E2, E3, E4, E5, E4, E5, and E7. What we are doing is, like as mentioned by Sujit sir, we are using symbolic execution, so concrete values will be represented by symbols here. So here A is getting the input value, I is equal to 2A. So it is represented like A equal to V1, I equal to 2V1. So similarly, it will proceed. And in order to reach this path, this will be the predicates we are taking. So using, and in order to take this path, we will take these two conditions to reach that. So from this trace, we will be generating path predicates. Like we will be conjuncting the branch predicate values, branch predicate logical expressions. We will conjuncting this three expressions to get a path predicate, and we'll be give this path predicate to an SMT solver, and if it is satisfiable, it will give us the values. Else, if it is not satisfiable, it will give us unsat. Whenever it is unsat, we need to do backtracking. Means we need to find out a satisfiable path. So here we are putting a light to a concept, longest viable prefix, where it is a prefix of a path where till the last statement, last decision statement, we don't know whether it is taking a satisfiable path or not. So in backtracking, what we are doing is like we will keep track of the edges in a stack. And we'll check whether the last edge is covered or not. If it is not covered, we will cover it. If it is already covered, we will pop that value and we'll check for the next value. This is the algorithm. And this is how we use SymTest in Simulink models. Here we have a Simulink model and we need to generate CFG from that model using D2. See, we generate a CFG for a Simulink model, and this CFG is fed into a SymTest model, and then we will generate test sequence. So the prototype was developed in Java, and it is available in this URL. And the SymTest performance, it is compared with a concolic testing tool like Crest. So and it is figured out that SymTest is far better than Crest. So the case studies we used are this elevator controller model, MATLAB automated cruise control model. So the SymTest is good for first time testing and regression testing. For first time testing, it's like it is desirable to cover the complete model. For regression testing, it is like in regression testing, it will be like some edges we will be interested in, because changes will be in some parts of the code. So here SymTest have the ability to give target edges. So it will be quite easy to do regression testing using SymTest. So these are the results. For first time testing, for SymTest, SymTest it gave almost 100% for three examples, three models. For Crest it is much lesser. And regarding regression testing, within two iteration itself, we were able to cover all the changes. Then strengths, SymTest was able to generate shorter test sequences, and we are considering the acyclic core target set. Then the main weakness is in the infeasibility of finding the path. Like the path we figured may be feasible or infeasible, and this infeasibility is currently it is managed by using backtracking only, but still if we are using backtracking, there are possibility of generating infeasible paths. So my work is like how to exploit SymTest in an industrial standard language like IEC 611313. So this is a language which is used to model programmable logic controllers. Then IEC does a suite of 5 languages. It consists of instruction list, structure test, ladder diagram, functional block diagram, and sequential function charts. So it's like all of these languages will be used in a single application. So there is, and we are using control builder program to develop PLC programs. So this control builder tool have the power to convert these 3, instruction list, function block diagram, and ladder diagram to structured test. So I'll be concentrating on the structured test of this IEC. So how we are using SymTest is like the control builder tool will generate the application, PLC application, and we'll fed it to an extractor. From there, we will, if there are FBD programs or ladder diagram programs, they will be converted to structure test, and the structure test part is extracted and it is fed to a parser, and the parser will generate the abstract syntax tree. Using this abstract syntax tree, we'll be generating the control flow graph, and this control flow graph is fed into SymTest, and later we'll be able to generate test sequence. But there are a lot of challenges in implementing SymTest in IEC. In the sense, the first thing is the infeasibility, as I mentioned before. We are currently now using only backtracking, so there's a wide area to think on, like if we are reaching an like non-feasible edge. We are just taking a one step back and checking whether we are getting a satisfiable path or not. Even if we are getting a satisfiable, just a single edge, later on it may end in some kind of infinite loop or something. So we need to make intelligent decision in moving towards the next edge. So we are planning to think on machine learning approaches in solving this program, in problem, sorry. Then the IEC specific challenges are like in PLC, an immense use of inter-procedure calls are there, because in PLC itself there are a lot of functions like sum, difference, up counter, down counter, a lot set of functions are there. So immense use of inter-procedure calls are there, and also we can also define our own function blocks in IEC. Next is timing constraints, that in PLC there are certain conditions that we need to complete certain functions within the within certain scan times. So timing is an important part of PLC programs. And then comes interrupts. Even if you are completing certain completing certain things within the scan time, if there is some kind of emergency, if you are clicking a stop button and we are like it will take the scan time to complete to go the system into shut. So in such cases, we will be using timing interrupts. So if it is interrupt, we will not need to complete the scan time. We will stop at that instance itself. So there will be a slight change of 2 to 250 millisecond difference will be there, but in real time applications, it matters a lot. So we need to consider these small timing issues and everything in symbolic execution part. So that is all about my work.
Yeah.
actually we are giving some target edges. So, parts for that. So actually we are getting test data in the sense when we fed this sequence to the solver will give the values. So I will get to look into it.
Thanks for the suggestion. Actually, we have given a thought on translating. So it turns out that to derive path-based coverage criteria from edge-based coverage criteria is slightly straightforward, not very complex. So in fact, it's the other way around in the sense that even if we start with a path-based coverage criteria, it could be decomposed into some sort of a edge-based coverage criteria. So we are basically, what we are producing here is our study on a very degenerate case of edge coverage, but it could be extended to other forms of coverage criteria. Okay, thank you, Varsha. So these are the two pieces of work that we wanted to showcase to you, which basically talk about automated software engineering. Yes, Sujit. Nothing, it was just a case study for us. We picked it up from MathWorks site and just used it as a case study. So they, it is a completely discrete valued, integer valued Simulink model. So it was very appropriate to be used as a case study for our algorithm. So that's all that our interest was on this particular case study. We didn't really look at it. We looked at it in the sense we had to translate it into control flow graph and stuff, but not with semantic interest. It was just a case study for us. Yes.
Yeah, so with this machine learning becoming popular, right? So one kind of interesting paradigm shift which is happening is that instead of telling the programmer, telling the computer, right, what to do in terms of this is how programming is done, we're trying to let the machine figure out how to solve the problem through data.
Right.
So a lot of these things which have traditionally been applied to code,
right,
there is a need to apply those kinds of techniques now to data. So
right.
This is a point that kind of recently also the keynote speaker at KDD made. He was talking about how in some sense the code is getting automatically generated,
right,
to essentially all these various machine robots learning techniques.
And
but now analogous to all of these code repositories and so on, you need to evolve the data set where you have this data set which is handling these corner cases, people, whatever, massaging the data and so on. So have you thought about kind of these data analogs of code in this new world, and what's the engineering, the equivalent of software engineering, or what's the data engineering or whatever the equivalent needed?
Honestly not. Only connection that I can draw is actually back to what Varsha just mentioned. So she was talking about this backtracking thing that we were talking. Of course, this does not answer your question. All I'm trying to say is we are interested in using data for our traditional software testing problem. So here, the backtracking is happening in a very traditional backtracking sense, as we backtrack in through graphs and trees. However, that happens to be a non-optimal strategy. That results in non-optimal test sequences as well as sometimes infinite loops. So the idea is that we would like to backtrack depending upon the situation that we are dealing with. And what that situation is, and depending upon the situation, what kind of backtracking could be done is actually an undecidable problem. But with a lot of machine learning and essentially mapping input scenarios to backtracking strategies, we could probably do a better job in deciding how much to backtrack by when we have to backtrack. So that is where we are trying to use data to solve this problem. But the other way around flow we have not thought about. Thank you. So these are two pieces of work, one working on the very top end of SDLC, that is requirement engineering, whereas the other one is to the fag end of the SDLC, which is testing. So with that, our contributions to AAC is done. Now I would like to discuss about two other pieces of work which we are doing that has not much to do with software engineering research, but kind of close to my heart, and I wouldn't have left them out. So essentially these are the SUPW work, and there are two pieces of work that I want to discuss with you on this. And it will not take too long. So the first piece of work is what we are doing with our colleagues in Vision Empower who are here, and Paul D'Souza from Touche Labs, Touche Tech Labs, and two students, Smith and Pratiksha, are working with us on this. So here is a refreshable Braille reader which Paul and his colleagues have developed, wherein we basically input a text file to this device, and then this allows a visually impaired person to actually read it in the form of Braille. So the translation from normal text to Braille is done by this particular device, and it allows the person to go back and forth through the text, and you know, conveniently. So considering that Braille books are extremely heavy and voluminous, this could be an you know, extremely useful device for visually challenged people, because it is supposed to be lightweight and, you know, very usable. So the existing system that Paul and his colleagues have developed is based upon a Raspberry Pi board, and it's reasonably powerful, but unfortunately it has a lot of stuff which is not really needed immediately for the use cases that we want to address, and that makes the whole thing power hungry. Because it is power hungry, we need a big battery. Because of the big battery, the whole thing becomes heavy and big, and that increases the form factor, that increases the cost. So this little thing about the board that, being too powerful for us, actually has a very big impact on the cost of the unit. So the whole objective is to bring down the cost drastically, and one of the things that we have decided to do is to use a very primitive computing platform, not Raspberry Pi, but something like an Arduino board, and redesign the whole software to run on that. The other very important use cases are to increase the support for Indian languages. Already there is some support, but with deciding to go for a primitive, smaller computing platform, this itself is an important challenge. They have been facing tremendous challenges in testing their units, because it involves mechanically moving components, and they are subject to wear and tear and damages, and therefore testing them is very important. Subjecting them to stress testing is very important. As of now, it is done manually, which is extremely expensive and time consuming. We have some ideas around, you know, how to automate those processes. So that is one of the things that we want to do. And then Supriya and her colleagues are basically trying to take these units to the visually challenged users and see how they find, actually. So ultimately they are the ones who will give us the verdict about how good a job we have done. So this particular part is being done by Supriya and her colleagues. And the ultimate goal is to produce a production-ready prototype. So currently we have already ported the whole thing successfully into Arduino, and we are able to run the current functionality on a much less featured board. So this is the one project that we are doing. The other project is about Anandawan. Anandawan is, and this project is being done with Professor Amit Prakash and Srujana Kamath, who is a digital society student. She has done her summer internship in Anandawan. So Anandawan is basically a village which was founded in 1951 by Baba Amte, who was one of the pioneer people who worked, who did pathbreaking work for leprosy patients and visually challenged people, physically challenged people. And from then to this day, you know, about 70 years, the entire village has actually become completely self-reliant. they have their own small scale industries which are enough to, they produce enough merchandise and value to make the entire system self-sustaining, not just in economic sense but also in terms of ecology and environment. There are two hospitals, a college, orphanage, school for blind, a school for deaf, and a technical wing. So this is the entire system of Anandawan, and what we try to do for them is essentially help them set up this health management information system. They already are using one which was donated to them by SAP Labs as their CSR activities. Unfortunately, fortunately or unfortunately, it's an extremely powerful system. Lots of detailed features are there, and they are so complex that, you know, so detailed that, you know, they are almost redundant and too complex for the people there who are not very adept in English. So there are language issues and stuff like that. So the goals that we approached with are to basically to see what kind of changes are needed in the current system, and then to explore the design space as to what could make this existing system more usable to the existing users there. So what Srujana did over the summer was, you know, she identified several issues with the current system. She developed several prototypes and ran them through the users and came out with a bunch of feedback. So that's where her summer project ended. We are carrying it forward to actually create implementations, which we will then take through user studies and see how far we can actually serve those people in their health management information system. So this was the other project that I want to just mention. I would now like to kind of wrap up. So, you know, I typically always give some philosophical this thing. So here is a little bit of philosophy. So all the projects that I do are essentially with one single aim, and that is to build useful and relevant things. I'm frankly not very well, my system is not very well oiled to create lots of publications. So I want to create stuff which people will be able to see and use, hopefully. You know, it's not an easy thing to do, but I do try to create stuff. So in the process, you know, if there is something which can be called as research, you know, that is a happy side effect for my work. But the main objective is to create something which is useful and relevant to people who are there in my life. They could be software engineers sitting across the road in Infosys. They could be visually impaired friends. They could be leprosy patients in Anandawan, etc. But the objective is to see people and see what they need and try to use our engineering and research skills to do something which brings value to their lives. So this is the basic philosophy with which I work, and hopefully my students work, and they probably do not curse me for that. You know, I think it's okay. There are a number of other projects that I'm doing. One project I'm doing with Professor Manish Gupta, and my student Nikhila is working on this as a part of her PhD project, and that is automated evaluation of programming assignments. The other project is on reverse engineering, where we try to extract architectural knowledge from existing legacy projects. These are all essentially revolving around themes of formal methods, program analysis, machine learning, and stuff like that. And there are many other small activities which are likely to turn into major projects in the coming time. And all this in you know, Samvaad season 2. So with that, you know, I would like to end my talk and would be very happy to take any questions. Yes, sir.
You mentioned about automation of software and the work that you will be doing with respect to either programming or testing. So, do you think that this is going to affect the labor in the IT industry, especially in the IT industry? Mostly involves routine maintenance, application programming, application maintenance, and testing. So, do you think that the profile of tomorrow's
So it has already been turning millions of people out of their jobs, this kind of work. So not just in future, but in present and past, it has earned enough credentials of killing jobs in industry. So yes, it is likely to be one of the side effects of what we are doing. We like to look at it as making programming more enjoyable, so that people can concentrate on more creative and intellectually challenging aspects of software development, while the menial tasks are taken out of their hands and given to software systems. Okay, thank you so much for your attention.